in South Potomac. Come on, let's stand together. Let's give God a great big hand of praise. We're going to worship God. We enter this house to worship Him, to celebrate Jesus. We're here. We're here for God. We are here for you.
His one and cannot escape from your presence. We cannot escape from your sight. Even in the belly of a whale, Lord God, you knew exactly where Jonah was. And God, so we know that you will never leave us. You will never forsake us, Lord God. And it's because of your Son who took our sin. You turned your face from him, Lord, just for a moment, because you could not look at the sin that he bore on that cross. Because it's not that everything's going to be good in our eyes, because it's not. But God, you're with us through those valleys, and you can use that for your glory, Lord God, so that we can be available as a vessel for you to pour into others that are going maybe through the same valley. You use us, Lord, as your hands and feet. So let us be willing and able to be all that we can be for you, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Christ in me. Really spoke to me today that we're here for him, that his love and protection would surround us, and that we need him every hour. And it brings to mind the scripture in Deuteronomy where Moses said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. And these commandments I give to you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit and when you walk along the road. When you lie down, when you rise up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and on your heads. Write them on the door frames of your house and on your gates. That's everything in and every way, every hour and all day. Recently, we just buried my father, and I was able to share God with him through his life, and he loved the scriptures and he loved the Lord and he loved people in a way that's impressive. Most people said that at the funeral over and over, how much he loved God and how much he loved and shared with other people. I pray that my life could be like that, that God's love would be in me every hour, every day, when I stand, when I sit, when I lie, when I walk, would be in my hands and my work and in my thoughts and my mind. And it would show from my gates and from my house that I serve the Lord. I'm here for him and that At the Last Supper, he took bread and broke it and said, "This is my body that will be broken for you," that he would suffer and die for our sins. Take it and eat. And he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant. It represents my blood, which will be shed for the forgiveness of sins, so that we might spend every hour of every day with him and in him, loving him and loving others in a right relationship." Take it and drink. Dear Lord, help us to remember you all the days of our lives and in every way, when we talk with our family, when we talk with others, when we minister to others, when we love them. Help us to love them with your love. In Christ's name, amen. We'll be up front in after the service for prayer if anybody is in need. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I want to remind you, as you give to the Lord, that whoever sows sparingly reaps sparingly. You plant in abundance, you tend to reap in abundance. Any of you just fertilize your yard? I did, and next month I'll be cursing, "Why is it growing so much?" And I'm the guy who did it. You will find that same thing to be true spiritually. By the way, Ernest, before you walk out, that was a great set. That was a beautiful set. Thank you. And the team. Thank the team. Man. One Sunday, we just need to sing the entire service. I would be in favor of that. Wouldn't you? Yeah, just sing our way. That would be beautiful to do. And just the principle of giving and watching the harvest of what God does. And so thank you for your faithful giving. Now, before we open God's word, I want to just take a minute, and I want you to say hello to three people up and down your row or next to you that you've not said hello to yet, but you couldn't have ridden in the car, even if you didn't talk. They don't count. Someone other than in your car. Can you stand and just give it a moment? Would you give it? So I want to talk to you just for a few moments about the word fellowship. It's a biblical term. It's used corporately. It's used universally. The definition fellowship is just the condition or relation of being a companion or being a peer, just being friendly to other people, not just to yourself but to other people. Now, we're pretty friendly with ourselves. When you say, some of you aren't friendly to yourself. Yeah, I've done that. Why did I hit myself on the thumb with the hammer? Why did I do that, Dave? I'm talking about not being friendly to myself. But for the most part, we're friendly to ourselves, but to be friendly with somebody else, okay? And so the idea is, it's, you know the saying, fellowship is two fellows on the same ship getting along, right? I know it's pretty corny, but it works. You'll remember that. Well, here's the... the issue that I see is that we're always in a hurry. We pull in, we arrive at church, we rush our way in, and you argue. I know what happens. You argue all the way up to the drive. Then that last 100 yards as you pull in, you have, okay, kids, put on the happy face. Let's get happy. We're gonna go see Jesus. And if you don't get happy, you will be seeing Jesus. You know. So then you pull in. And then the line starts. People outside the building greet you and go, "Hey, good morning, how you doing?" You go, "Fine." And your nose is like, it's like that, right? You ever had this, right? Yeah. Happens a lot. It's the reason some couples drive separately. You know? It's the reason Wanda and I put a glass wall between the front row and the back of the van. But there's a warfare that happens. You don't get to just relax and enjoy the fellowship. So sometimes you just need to do that. And so we're taking a Sunday here in a couple weeks, and we're just going to fellowship together. Now, by that, what I mean is we're just going to hang out with no agenda other than to catch a name, learn a story, learn something about somebody, enjoy the friendship. We'll play a yard game or two. And so what I want you to do is, if you have you have a lawn chair, anybody have a lawn chair? Some of you, yeah, got lawn chairs, bring them. And then I find it actually is an opportunity for me to trade up to a better lawn chair, because when we're going home, it's worked for me. Bring a yard game, something like, any of you have cornhole? Okay, I need you to bring the cornhole. I need you to bring, any of you have that ladder, ball, rope thing? Do you know what I'm talking about? Any of you have darts, lawn darts? Do not bring those. Do not bring lawn darts. Rifles, pistols, don't bring those, okay? Bocce ball, anybody know what bocce ball is? We're gonna do a new thing too. The teens have been playing, and they're really good at it. It's called pickleball. Anybody play pickleball? I tell you what pickleball is. Pickleball is table tennis, but you don't have to be in shape. So I love it, because you could just kind of hit it, and then you just step and hit it. You're not running around like an idiot the whole time. So I remember my first lesson in humility was, I was in the eighth or ninth grade. My dad took me to the YMCA. We played handball. Do you know what handball is? Yeah, my dad, I thought, was a good Christian until we got into that little room, to which he had me running into walls, and he was just having a good time. And I think it was like 21-1. I think he gave me 1 point, you know. And I was, not only was I not good at it, but he let me know that he was the boss. He was, with pickleball, you don't have to be in great shape, you don't have to know how to play it, you don't have to, nothing. There's very little talent, mostly enjoying the time together. So we'll do some of that. Nine Square, we're gonna try to set that up as well. Now, here's what's gonna happen. We're gonna have worship like this, but then we're not gonna just run right out and get a burger, because I know it will happen. As soon as you eat, you'll lay in the back of the car and take a nap. We're not gonna do that. So we're not even gonna fire up the grills, nothing till church is over. Because if you went home, you'd be an hour before you ate anyway. So after church, we'll fire up the grills. You'll play a little bocce ball, sit in the lawn chair, and chat for a little bit, and then we'll eat, we'll have a little bite to eat, and then you'll go home and take your nap, okay? And all God's people said, amen, good. So now, if you're watching online, let me tell you this. This is the perfect weekend for you to come back, because you can walk in, and people can say, I haven't seen you forever, and you could say to them, because you're watching online, you could say, well, I saw you in church. You could do that, because you did, you saw them on church. But this is a great weekend if you've been watching online. And but the whole idea is not the burger or the brat or whatever it is that we're going to have. That's not the idea. The real big idea is fellowship, because it's just getting to enjoy the friendship of God's people. I learned wonderful things about you that I just didn't know, and people that I knew for a while, and stuff you didn't know about me or I didn't know about you. Just, it's fascinating. Okay. Now, if you have a Bible, go with me to, we're going to begin in Psalm 127. But we're really going to camp in Genesis 2 and Joshua 24. So those two you want to open. But I'm going to just begin by reading from Psalm 127. The series is called First Comes Love, Then Comes Baggage. And so each weekend now, what I want you to bring is not baggage, because we all have that already. What I want you to bring is commitment. That's what I want to talk about. That's the word today. Lord, help us as we open your word and to hear it well, we pray. Thank you. In Christ's name, amen. Unless the Lord builds the house, Psalm 127, the builders labor in vain. Unless the Lord watches over the city, the guards stand watch in vain. In vain you rise up early and stay up late, toiling for food to eat. For he grants sleep to those he loves. Children are a heritage from the Lord, offspring a reward from him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in the court. The home is blessed by God, and unless the Lord builds that home, it's not going to get built. The home is God's idea. Unless the Lord builds the house, doesn't matter what you do, it will come up to nothing. And so he goes on to say, unless you build it God's way, it'll be in vain. Work on it all you want, it'll just be action, but no end product that you really want. You can choose to do something else and build on a different foundation than the Lord, and when you do, at the end of the day, you'll be tired. You'll be exhausted. You'll get up early to go to work, you'll bring it home, and the money flows, doesn't it? You make more money. Have you ever gotten a raise and then 3 months later you can't figure out where it went? Yeah, I don't feel like I got a raise, but I did get a raise. Yeah, you've had that. You toil hard, you get up early, you work hard. And then the Lord blesses you with children, and they are a blessing. They really are a blessing. Children are a gift from the Lord. When you got married, you walked into the relationship, and maybe you moved into an apartment or a flat or a house, some kind of unit somewhere. You moved in, and you brought your stuff with you. And maybe you were getting out of college, or you had college suitcases and college stuff. So mostly your bookshelves were like bricks with blocks, with wood, you know, just, right? College kind of dorm type settings. You don't have a whole lot. But when you start, you carry all that stuff in. What you don't see is the baggage that you carry into the relationship. Oh, the baggage. The expectation. Who handles money in the relationship? Who doesn't handle money? What a day off looks like. What does a day off look like? How many of you, a day off means you just stay home in your pajamas? Don't raise your hand. How many of you, that means you go out someplace? Hey, it's expectation. That's the baggage you bring. It's the vacation, the expectation of vacation. Some people, vacation is going to see relatives. Other people, it's no, going anywhere where there are no relatives. We're going to go somewhere else. How many of you, vacation was always relatives? Yeah, some of you. How many of you just went, you went sightseeing? And others of you go, we never had a vacation, ever. Yeah. Baggage that you carry in, like how you disagree, how you agree, how you disagree, how do you come to a conclusion, how you treat one another when you disagree. Who is the alpha in the family, and when does the alpha appear? How does that happen? And some of us carry into the relationship baggage of hurts or of scars. That's serious stuff, isn't it? And you hardly know it's there, and then you think you've tamped it down, and then after you've been married a while, it comes back, it emerges. I want to talk with you about carrying the right thing into the relationship. And today what I want to center is just the word commitment. Unless the Lord builds the house. The commitment I'm going to give you in three terms. It's consecration, communication, cooperation. Consecration, communication, and then cooperation. You can turn to society and to media and whatever and see how government defines family or how government models the family or what school districts do or communities do. But family was God's idea. If you're in Genesis 2, look with me. By the way, Genesis 2 is real early in history. How do I know that? Because in front of Genesis 2 is Genesis what, class? 1. And in front of Genesis 1 is what? Holy Bible. This is the beginning, right? This is pretty early in history. Genesis 2, verse 20. And for Adam, there was found no suitable helper. No suitable helper was found. Verse 21. So the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs, closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. And there are lots of pictures about this, that this woman is beside you. You're not over her. She's not over you. This comes out of your side. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She'll be called woman, for she's taken out of man." And that's why a man leaves his father and mother. We're going to come back to this in a little bit. That's why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife. They become one flesh. And Adam and his wife were both naked. They felt no shame. A lot of things will contribute to your family life. This is ultimately not only the first creation of man and woman, but this is the first marriage. And he's really defining what that looks like. And then later, Jesus will restate it, and then the epistles will actually kind of formulate. They'll say, no, this is the way it is. This is a commitment for a lifetime. But you see, the way that commitment starts, it will affect your personality and your security, your real sense of your self-image, your willingness to take a risk, and for faith, and for thinking, overall health. And it is the word commitment. Commitment. Can you say the word out loud? 1, 2, 3. Boy, that was pretty good. It sounded like, whew, yeah. We love that word on others, and we're not always sure we like it on ourselves. We make the commitment at the last possible moment. That's why in the ads, they'll say, "Hurry now, stock is limited." And then I say, "Yeah, you're just going to go out to the truck and get another limited supply." You know, it really never runs out. But this offer is only good to this time. Why do they do that? Because they know that we don't like commitment. Commitment to us, I mean, long-term commitment to us is a 2-year phone contract, right? Like, why do I have this thing? This is really old. And so we like it, but we don't like it on ourselves. We just like it on other people. But when we talk about the family, there has to be this level of commitment. In other words, there's absolutely no turning back. There's a story from early American history. I think the guy's name is Balboa. He was one of those discovery guys. And he was going along the coast of what's now the United States. Actually, the southern section down Carolinas to Florida. But there was a problem, and it was a bad morale with the guys, and they were ready to go back. They went, I don't like this. They didn't like it. And Balboa issued the decree. Do you know what it was? Burn the ships. We're not going back. And by doing that, they made the commitment to stay. Some of you are just, and I'm not talking about horribly warped marriages where there's affairs and there's tons of deception. That may be a discussion for another day. But some of you are just wondering about how committed you want to be. And I'm saying to you, you just need to cut off the other relationships that keep you distracted from the devotion you could have to the committed one, because it could be a great relationship if you'll see through the commitment. Well, that's Genesis 2. The family is now developing. God, in God's story, if I could walk you through 50 chapters of Genesis, here's what happens. The world populates. As it does, God chooses a people. They're called the Hebrews, later called the Jews. They're God's chosen people. And why are they God's chosen people? Because he's God. He gets to pick. Okay? That's good. So he picks the chosen people, but they don't listen to God. And so by the end of Genesis, guess where they are? They're in slavery because they didn't listen. They didn't obey. Do any of you have kids that don't listen? Don't obey. Do you know where they got that from? Yeah. Boy, I hate that. Sometimes I've said this last week. Sometimes I open my mouth and my mother comes out. That sounds just like something my mother would have said or my father would have said. Yeah, I am not far from them. Well, so they land in slavery. That's the end of Genesis. So that's book number one. Book number two is the book of Exodus. That's the book of them exiting the slavery. It's the story of Moses. But while they're exiting, Leviticus is also written. Leviticus is the extension of the laws. They get the Ten Commandments in Exodus. They get hundreds more laws in Leviticus. And in Numbers, they have to number the people. They have to run a census. Why? Because we keep traveling and they're waiting for people to die so we can go back into the promised land. If Uncle Bob would just die, we could move on. That's where this is going. That's Numbers. It sounds terrible, but it was true. Every day, the children of Israel, as they traveled in the desert, they had funerals all the time. The good news is it was sand. It was easy to dig. Okay. Some of you are saying, is that in the notes? No, that's free. Okay. Genesis, you have the beginning of God's people. They land in slavery. Exodus, they exit. This is the story of the Exodus. They get the Ten Commandments. Leviticus, they're getting more of the law. Numbers, that's the census of the people. And Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy is the word for, we're saying this over again. It's the restatement of the previous four books. It takes one book for them to get into trouble. It takes four books for them to get out of it. Have any of you ever gotten in trouble and then found out, boy, getting out of trouble is a lot harder than getting into trouble? I have both hands up. It's longer, it's more expensive, it takes more effort, right? I've had people eating cheesecake going, I'm gonna regret this. I'm gonna regret this. I don't know why I put it on my lips. I should just put it right on my hips. That's free. Okay. So we're through five books. Now enough people have died that now there's a new leader and Moses is now dying. That's the end of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The next book is the book of Joshua. And Joshua chapter 1 opens with Moses, my servant's dead. We're ready to go into the promised land. So he's led them all the way out through the Exodus. Now we're ready to go into the promised land. They're about to cross the river. There's a lot of symbolism happening. Read the book of Joshua. It's an inspiring book. Don't lean left. Don't lean right. You obey. Pay attention. It's the same message all throughout the scripture. Pay attention. Don't deviate from the word of God. That's Joshua chapter 1. So they go in and they take over the land. It would be the promised land for them. They get in, they move in, they have a lot more victories than they have defeats. But they still have defeats because the people still aren't totally convinced because they still go back to these old ways. Why? Because it's what we knew. And so the Hebrew people, even though they're winning with God, they still understand brokenness and slavery and estrangement and idolatry. They have known nothing about good models, but they've seen a lot of bad models. And we think our society is bad, but they had, just within the first five books, now book six of the Old Testament, they had child sacrifice, euthanasia, killing of the elderly. They had seen attempts of race annihilation and sodomy and bestiality and orgies would continue all throughout the Old Testament. You're going, you're kidding, that's all there? Yes, it is. The Bible is not G-rated or even PG. It might be PG-13, but there are sections that might actually be R because there's the sin takes all kinds of deviant, stray wanderings within the text. And so having seen all of that, Joshua comes to the end of his life and they've conquered the land, they've gone in, but he knows their hearts aren't still fully committed because they still want to go back to what they call these Asherah poles. These are poles of false gods. So he says, Joshua chapter 24, if you flip over there, keep your hand in Genesis 2. Joshua 24, verse 14. He's about to die. And he says, now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Fear the Lord, people. Serve him with all faithfulness. He's not even talking about family. He's just talking about your own soul right now. He goes, throw away the gods of the ancestors worshipped beyond the Euphrates River in Egypt. So he's saying, back when we were in slavery, okay, back in the old country, you still carry some of that stuff forward. So he says, give up what you've worshipped beyond the Euphrates and in Egypt and serve the Lord. By the way, when you dump that old stuff, you need to then serve the Lord. It's a matter of substitution. If you don't fill it with something, it will fill itself back in. So you have to not only take off, this is Ephesians, you not only take off the bad habit, you have to put on a new habit. You have to stop telling a lie and start telling the truth. You have to put off the shame and put on the garments of praise, okay? Around our house, we call it changing the channel. We'll be talking and it'll get negative and I'll just go, let's change the channel. You ever do that? You should try that. It works. We don't need to do this anymore. Okay, he's saying, get that off of that, get onto this and serve the Lord. Verse 15, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, he's not forcing them, get this? If it seems undesirable, then choose for yourselves this day who you will serve. Then make up your mind, but don't be double-minded about this. Make up your mind who you will serve, whether it's the gods of your ancestors beyond you, beyond the Euphrates. What were you called there? Oh, yeah, slaves. Slaves. He says, if that's what you want, go back to that. Or the gods of the Amorites in the land who you were living, that's when they were traveling through, about to go into the promised land. But he says, as for me and my household, I know what we're doing. We're going to serve the Lord. We're not backing down. That's me. We're burning the ships. You get that? It's Balboa all over again. There's no turning back here. So just decide, commit, because half-hearted commitment always lands a disaster. How many of you have ever driven on an interstate? Okay, you need to get out more. Okay, so once every 2 or 3 years, there'll be an off-ramp, but it's real busy, and it could be, you know, in a metropolitan area, and you've seen this. I've seen it more than once. And it's the double-minded person, and they can't decide if they're going to get off the interstate or not. So what do? They plow into the exit sign. Have you seen this before? And they can't get off, but they don't want to get off. And you can hear the discussion. Get off. No, don't. Get on. Stay on. Get, oh, yeah. Right there. And then there'll be like a gaper's delay, because that'll show up on the evening radio, and they'll say, scoot by, take a picture, because it's these people still arguing, should we have gotten off or not? Do one or the other, but you can't do both. It's called a wreck. And that's the way life will be. In fact, the book of Revelation tells that too. It's either running hot or cold, but when it's lukewarm, that's just nasty. It's just nasty. That's a biblical term for spew thee out of your mouth. And we use our modern word, nasty. So I've seen couples with good chemistry, good personality, great experiences. I've seen them with good family roots. You've seen them too. And environment and resources. But none of those factors overwhelm quite like the factor of commitment. Let me tell you too. I've performed weddings where I've gone home and gone, I don't know. I don't know. I may have just committed a terrible thing. And my wife will say, oh, let's change the channel. Let's talk about something different. And you know what? 20 years later, they're still tooling along. Do you know why? Because they're committed to the Lord. And they don't have the biggest house or the best. No, it doesn't matter. They're committed to the Lord. It's just a wonderful thing. And they're committed to each other. They're committed to each other. One of the top Dove Award winners is a guy by the name of Stephen Curtis Chapman, songwriter. And I think it's a cute story. He dates a girl in college, and they share the same mailbox because at Anderson University, they've just alphabetized them. Well, her last name was Chapman, and his last name was Chapman. So they had to share mailboxes. So he would open up, that was to Mary Beth, he'd put it back, because his name's Stephen. Well, then he finally meets this Mary Beth. They fall in love, get married. Well, then they have children. Well, now they have Grandma and Grandpa Chapman and Grandma and Grandpa Chapman. How often does that happen? Not very often. And there's some wonderful things in their lives. They're wonderful, godly people. I highly recommend Stephen's music. But tragedy struck Mary Beth's home, and the parents' marriage didn't make it. And then she became a little fearful, like, if theirs isn't rock solid, just... are we going to make it? Just like that's what, which is a real thought. And Stephen sat down and wrote, tomorrow morning when you wake up and the future isn't clear, I will be here. I will be here no matter what. And he wrote the love song to his wife to say, we are going nowhere. That's burn the ship's time. That's that commitment that I'm talking about. Now, if you have commitment to family but not to the Lord, Get this. You have to get this, because this is very subtle. And I have fallen into this. I'm not preaching to you. I'm telling you my own personal experience. When you have commitment to family and not commitment, and it outdoes your commitment to God, do you know what you have? If anything is in front of God, what is that? That's an idol. That's an idol. And he's saying, you cast those idols down, Joshua 24. And if you put your kids in front of God, they're the idol. And here's the funny thing about your kids. Your kids will drain your account and then walk away, smiling, laughing, right? They just do. And so if you put all of your energy, all of your life into your children, and you go, well, we do it for the kids, big mistake. Do you know why? Because one day you give 100% to the kids, and then one day they get up and go to college or go to vocational school or move out and get a job. They're on their own. And do you know what you have? You got zip, because you've put nothing into it. You see what's happened? You're looking at each other, husband and wife, and you're strangers. Why? Because we did it for the kids. Everything you did was for the kids. That's a false god. That's an idolatry. So, and by the way, children will take from you as long as, if they run your schedule and your time and take all your money, that's an addiction, people. And you need to set some margin. One of the best things we did, we just had tea time at night. Our kids head to bed, we bathe them, read to them, pray with them, get them down, then duct tape them in. We didn't duct tape them. They'd get up, get a glass of water, and then run to the restroom again. And we'd finally get them settled down. And Wanda said, I just want to have time, just 15 minutes. Or it doesn't have to be an hour every night, just a little bit of time. And we would make chamomile tea and just talk about our day, just as a couple. I'm so glad she said, let's do this. And that was restorative to us as a couple, but allowed us to recenter and see what we're doing and then plan our week. It allowed us some relaxed time together as a couple. Because get this, in your home, children are temporary. They will eventually leave. The relationship as a couple is the permanent one, okay? Now, commitment to God without commitment to the family is hypocrisy. So you have idolatry, hypocrisy. So look at commitment to the Lord twofold. First is for me and my household, to the Lord, right? Starts with the Lord. I'm committed to the Lord. So even if my spouse isn't committed to the Lord, I'm still going to be committed to the Lord. And I'm committed through, now that we have more revelation, Jesus Christ is Savior and coming King. I follow Him as Lord over all. And that commitment then to the Lord becomes part of my commitment to the spouse. And then the second part of that, now my extension of my commitment to the Lord now becomes a commitment to my family. I do this out of my love for the Lord. And that makes way more sense. And in a society that is commitment phobic, you'll be steady, you won't be overreactive, you won't be speculative, there won't be distrust, because you know, you set your sails, you know what drives you, and it's your commitment to the Lord that doesn't change, which then falls into this family piece, which is next. And you're saying, I don't even know what my commitment would be as a couple. I don't know what that would be. That's the great question. So I want to go back to Genesis 2, because I want you to see this. This is so simple, but it's so good. The Word of God, says in Hebrews, is living and powerful, sharper than a double-edged sword. It knows us. It knows us so well, written hundreds and hundreds of years earlier, and yet it is so prescriptive to our lives. Go back to Genesis 2, pick up at verse 24. This is why a man leaves his father and mother. Wait right there. There was no father and mother in Genesis 2. You get this? This is the first couple. And yet what's he writing? He's writing almost prophetically. Do you get that? That's how he's saying this is the way it's going to be. The guy has to leave mother and father and be united to his wife. Let me stop there. Leave mother and father. How many of you know a couple where the guy has not left mama? Point to them now. Just point to them. Yeah. Big mistake. United to his wife. They become one flesh. Adam and his wife, both naked, felt no shame. Right there, four corners or foundational corners of the house that you're going to build. Number one, leave. Cut the ties. Leave mom and dad for good. Some of you in the room today, I don't know who you are, you need to go home today, call your kids and say, I need the keys. Oh, and I need a credit card. You can't keep using my debit card. Hand it in. Okay? That's okay to do. leave mom and dad. Honor your mother and father. Love them. Honor them. But if your adult children, if you have adult children, if your adult children know that they can always bail out and go home to mama, they will. Okay? For me, when I left home, I left home, went to college, I got married. I love my mom and my dad, great, great people. There was no lure for me to go back, none. You're saying, even the cooking? Especially the cooking. My mother couldn't cook, she burned water. I mean, it was awful. She just was not a good cook. It was amazing that my dad made it past 80. I mean, system, like, how do you do this? He goes, I eat a lot of cereal, Dave. I ate a lot of cereal. You can't burn cereal, Dave. Okay, got you, Dad. It's good for you. It's whole grain. It's good for you. Yes. I don't know. Anyway, I love my mom. Great person, but no desire. I can tell you this story, and then I'll get, when I get to heaven, I'll apologize for it later. But you know, my wife's a family and consumer science major, and she had food labs, which is the science, the chemistry that would go into the food labs for chefs, basically. But then she also did ProServe, which is like restaurant work, and then did just all kinds of stuff. Well, then she had a chemistry class that was a baking class that had visiting chefs in, and they made a chocolate cake that made your jaw ache. It was so good. I mean, so good. So she makes this thing. Well, my dad makes the mistake of getting a bite of this. And he goes, oh, this is the best thing I've ever eaten in my life. I would gladly, you know, he was ready to pull his teeth out by the cavities he'd get from this chocolate cake, because there was a pound of cocoa. I mean, just the stuff that was in it. They were throwing sticks of butter into the recipe. It was just like a heart attack on a plate, but you willingly took it. I mean, it was just that good of a... So my mom was a little vexed of spirit, if you will, you know, she's a little honked off, and I was clueless this whole thing. Wanda knew what was happening. I had no clue. She says to Wanda, can I have that recipe? Okay, you can have it. But you know, you have to steam it, stir it, it has to be frothed. I don't even understand these terms. These things have to be done a certain way, and my mom, that's not my mom, it's not who she is. It's not. My dad didn't marry her for cooking. He married her because she played the piano and he was going to preach. He needed a piano player. I'm just being honest. We're in church, okay? And she was a real good piano player, but man. Anyway, but Wanda would like stir the cream until it frothed right that moment, and then she would dump this cocoa in. I mean, there's certain things that had to be done, and you separated the eggs. I didn't know you used to separate eggs. I didn't know what the egg separator thing was for. I don't know why you would do this. Why would you estrange the yolk from the white? Why would you, you know, oh yeah, there's a reason. She had all that down. So my mom makes the cake, and my dad, God rest his soul, he's in heaven, it's over. So he eats it, and he goes, oh yeah, it's not nearly as good as Wanda's. Well, oh my gosh. The next three or four times I was by the house, he was just riding the lawnmower around the yard. I'm not going back in there, not for a while. Cut the ties, people. Okay? Now that I've told you that story, you won't tell anybody, okay? Just keep it to yourself. Number two, be united. Think of yourselves as one. You leave mother and father, be united to your spouse. Here's the problem. You're single so long that when you get married, it's hard to think as a couple. So you still think single. You still say I instead of we. You have to start thinking we. Okay? So Well, here's the deal, though. If you don't think that way as a couple, and let me check my schedule. Let me just go back and look at the household schedule. If you don't do that, a house divided against itself, Jesus put it this way, it can't stand. It's not going to stand if you're constantly in conflict. You have to be united. And by the way, you think children are a blessing, and they are, Psalm 127. Also, children know how to divide mom and dad. Can I get an amen? They know how to play you. You're being played. Every moment they're breathing, they're thinking of the next move. They are sinners, and they need Jesus. But the couple cannot stand. I mean, Abraham Lincoln said, a country divided against itself cannot stand. Lincoln says this, I mean, he knows it from the Bible. It just doesn't work. So cut the ties, number one. Number two, be united. Number three, risk being open. It says in the text, they're naked. There's no secrets, nothing between them. But there's nothing between them, no jobs, no other friends. They have other friends, but we just don't do stuff. I love it, and other guys have had this rule. It's called the Billy Graham rule. They don't go alone with another woman someplace. And you know why? You know what? Billy Graham went to heaven without a scandal. We don't do that stuff. We don't do this stuff that looks bad, that just, this could be trouble later. Because that's how the affairs start. It's just coffee, then we work on a project because you're working on something together, then you meet afterwards, then you end up doing dinner because work went longer. And you never meant for it to happen, but that's how the division happens, very slowly, very subtly. So you always, you leave mother and father, you're united to each other, and then you risk being absolutely open. No one can cut in. And then it has to be a safe zone. There's no shame. So even when you do blow it, you can say, I'm sorry, I blew it. I didn't get it right. And you will do that. I love what Rick Warren says. Marriage is the union of two good forgivers. Wow. It's really true. You can share your thoughts, and you may say, you know what, you're 40 years old, and they say, well, what would you like to do? And you say, you know what, when we were kids, I always wanted to play in the band, I never could. Why? Well, you didn't have the money. We didn't have the money to rent the instrument. Well, what would you like to play? This over again, this is what I would do differently. So, consecrate. Unless the Lord builds the house, number one. Then communicate. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Are you getting this together? You got it together? And then cooperate. Leave. Be united. One flesh. No shame. What we do together. We do it for the love of the Lord. We do this as under the Lord. So even if the other one strays, you still can't lose because you know where you're headed. You know where your true north is to follow the Lord. And so... So I leave you with this. Unless the Lord builds the house, forget the house for a moment. Unless the Lord builds your life, are you following the Lord? Because for some of you, you say, well, I can do all that, but you're still not following the Lord. Everything that's going to happen for you may have some short-term wins, but ultimately it's going to be in vain. So my word to you is this, follow the Lord. If you've never trusted Christ as Savior, turn to him, open your heart, tell him, I know Jesus is Savior of the world. I need him to be Savior for me. I have blown it. You can be open with him. He is not willing that any should perish. He doesn't want you to die in your sin. He wants you to come to him and repent, turn to him in faith. He promises to take you in. He promises to forgive. When you get that kind of sense that you're forgiven, all the rest of the relationships will fall into place. And how do I know that? Because when you seek first the kingdom of God, all the other things will fall into their proper place. Let's bow for prayer and let's stand as we pray. Some of you just right where you're standing would say, Lord, I need to trust Christ as Savior right now. And so you're doing that. You're doing business with God. Others would say, you know what, God? My heart has been far from you, and I am not following the Lord. Would you give us, God, give us guts to say something in the car going home today? Something simple, not anything profound. Give us guts to start that conversation. But what would it be like as a couple to follow the Lord fully? And God, whatever it is that you want to do in our lives, we give you open access today. And may, it's one of the things I love about SPC is we just, we're quick to forgive. We're a grace-filled place. Make us gracious in our own hearts, towards our own selves, and towards the people we're in tight relationships with. And God, may at the end of the day, may it bring a smile to your face as we live according to your word. Bless these dear people, we pray in Christ's name. Everybody, amen.
You promised me. You never leave. You promised me. I'm never the same.